more or less understood the concept of free body diagram and how to represent the common type of forces, etc. So before we get into the homework assignment and questions and all that from that, we will take a quick recap of the concept of you know, pulleys and how tension acts within a system which consists of a pulley or multiple pulleys and threads and all that. Okay, so last time we were talking about the role played by a pulley, where we understood that an ideal pulley. So let's look at some examples of pulley based systems. Okay, so the thing that we have to keep in mind about pulley based systems is that an ideal pulley is one which has a smooth surface, okay, and it is massless, okay, or is very light. So these two properties become very important, and at a later stage we will see pulleys of a different type which have a rough surface and which are heavy, and we will see that there the dynamics is somewhat different. Okay, so we had understood that the three-dimensional picture of that pulley is more or less like this. You have a disc kind of thing or a cylinder kind of thing which is attached to two discs or like a wheel like this, and this whole thing is mounted on an axle. Okay, and when we say that the surface of the pulley is smooth, we mean that this surface is the one which is smooth. Okay, so any thread that we've got wound around this surface, if you pull the thread from one end, it just slips out without any friction. Okay, without the pulley rotating or anything, it is just mounted on a fixed axle. Because the surface of the pulley is smooth, so the thread is just able to slip out. Okay, so as a result of that, the important thing that happens here is that the tension in the string remains uniform in magnitude on both sides of the pulley. So because it has got a smooth surface, what happens is that the tension in the thread, okay, or string wound around the pulley, this tension remains uniform. It's uniform in magnitude. Okay, if the surface of the pulley had been rough, then this would not have been the case. Okay, so what we would have noticed that till now, whatever questions we had discussed last time, so if there was a pulley like this and there was a thread where one side of the thread is here and one side of the thread is here, okay, attached to two blocks or whatever, okay, then we took the same tension on this part of the thread as a tension on this part of the thread. Now why that is happening, that the tension on either side of the pulley with the thread wound around in between, that tension, why it is uniform? Because there is no interaction in terms of tangential force, or there is no interaction in terms of friction between the surface of the pulley and the thread. If there had been friction, then the tension on this side would have been different than the tension on this side. Okay, so this is something very important to remember, that because of this smooth surface, okay, what happens, that and partly because of the thing being massless, the tension in the thread is uniform on either side, okay, of the pulley. So that's an important thing. Okay, so let's quickly now do a question or two based on this, then we'll come back to your assignment questions. So still we have to learn few tricks about solving pulley based systems, and that is why I'm emphasizing on this to begin with. So next example for us is like this, that we have, let us say, an inclined plane, okay, which is at an inclination of, let us say, 37 degrees, my favorite angle, with respect to the horizontal, and this is a smooth surface. Okay, now what we've done is we've kept one block here, okay, and that is attached to a light thread. Now this thread is going to go around the disc of a pulley like this, or around the cylinder of a pulley. Just a minute. So this pulley is attached to this corner, okay, and the thread is going around it, and then the other side of the thread is coming down vertically like this, and that is attached to another block. So this is the situation now. Now let us assume that mass of block A over here is, let's say, 10 kilograms, and mass of block B is, let us say, 5 kilograms, and the acceleration due to gravity is 10 meters per second square. So we have to find the acceleration of blocks A and B. Okay. And we have to find the tension in the thread. Okay. And as usual, even if it's not given in the question directly, we will always assume that the thread is a standard thread, so it is massless and also inextensible. That means it's not elastic in nature. Okay, the thread is massless, means it's very light. Of course, I've told you nothing can be perfectly massless, but its mass is negligible compared to the mass of the blocks, which is in kgs. So the thread is massless and inextensible. So inextensible ka matlab kya hai? That it does not extend in length under tension. It remains of fixed length. Okay. So it is inextensible, and also the pulley is also a standard pulley. So the pulley is smooth and massless. Okay. So just try this question out now. So what you'll have to do in this question is you'll have to make the free body diagrams. Okay. Yeah, that is the point. Na? Dekho, string, the Krish, the point is that string is massless. So the tension in one whole section of the string has to be uniform. And the pulley surface is smooth. So the tension on either side of the pulley also has to be the same. That means there is the same magnitude of tension everywhere. Okay, see, this tension on this side is the same as the tension at the top of the string here. Why? Because this is a massless string. Then the tension on the left of the pulley is equal to the tension on the right of the pulley. Why? Because it's a standard pulley, so it is smooth. The surface of the pulley is smooth. And then again, this tension is equal to this. Why? Because it's a massless thread. Understood the point? So, everywhere there will be a uniform tension. That is the concept we have to understand. Now the main problem here is that we are not sure whether the block A will be sliding up and B will be going down, or B will be going up and A will be sliding down. Okay, so we are not sure about the direction. Yeah, so that we have to see the resolution of the forces properly. Okay, so obviously you have to resolve the forces. So the next step is that you have to make the free body diagrams. Okay, FBDs of A and B, and in that, on A, forces have to be resolved. So that step is obviously there, but also one important point is here, we may not be sure about the direction. Directions of accelerations. So how do we write the equations then? Okay. So the answer to that is very simple. We will just make some assumption. Either the assumption will be that A is going up and B is coming down, or vice versa, and we will solve the equations. Now if our assumption is correct, then our acceleration will come with a positive sign. If our assumption is wrong, the acceleration will come with a negative sign, which means we have to just reverse the direction. Okay, so what we will do is we will write the equations from the free body diagrams. Okay, assuming some particular direction. Okay, so let's assume, suppose let that we assume E is sliding down the incline, and therefore obviously B is moving vertically up. Okay, now the thing is, with that assumption, on solving the equations, if acceleration comes out to be positive quantity, then the direction will be as assumed. Okay, whereas if acceleration comes out to be negative, that means the direction, the directions are opposite, okay, to what was assumed. It's as simple as that. So we don't need to change anything, we just change the direction of the acceleration in this case. Okay, so I am assuming in this question now that E is accelerating down the inclined plane. My assumption may be correct, may be wrong. How I'll find out whether my assumption is correct or wrong? By solving the free body diagram equations, and if E comes out to be positive for me, then my assumption will be correct. Okay, so let us try these steps next. So just do the steps as I have said. Make the free body diagrams, resolve the forces for E, assume this direction of acceleration and write the equations. On solving the equations, if I'm getting E as positive, then my assumption is correct. If I'm getting E as a negative quantity, then I have to just reverse the direction of my acceleration. Rest, my magnitude of acceleration will still be correct. There won't be any problem. Okay, so I want all of you to try this out. Make the free body diagram of E and B correctly and try to get the resolution of the forces for the block A correctly. We have done quite a few problems of inclined plane forces, normal reaction on inclined plane earlier. So you know how to resolve the forces, just apply that concept over here. Additionally, there is just tension in the thread. Okay, so hope you have started with this process by now. So I'll just make the FBD myself, but you continue with what you're doing with the free body diagram. Try to get it correct yourself. Okay. So for E, the forces acting are the three forces: tension, normal reaction, and weight. Okay. Okay. So this is the axis which is perpendicular to the inclined plane. Okay. And this is along the inclined plane. So as you know, the normal resolution, how we do it, the inclined plane is making theta with the horizontal axis. So mg will make the same theta with the normal axis. Okay. Now the other important thing is that we know the acceleration of the body A is down the inclined plane. So the direction of the acceleration is like this. So because the direction of the acceleration is like this, we will take this as our x-axis. And we will take this as our y-axis. So we will now have to resolve mg. Okay. So on resolving mg, my free body diagram will change like this. Okay. Let normal reaction and tension be the way they are, because they are already along the axis that I have chosen. So normal reaction is along this axis, tension is along this axis. Okay. So these two forces are not affected by any resolution. Okay. But the mg I will now resolve. Okay. So this force I have to resolve. So the component of mg that is along this direction will become which component? It will become the cos component. Okay. Because the angle with this axis was theta. So that jis angle ke saath, I mean jis axis ke saath angle theta hai, that component becomes which component? It becomes the cos component. And the angle with this axis is 90 minus theta. So this component of mg will become what? It will become mg sine theta. So this is mg sin theta. And my acceleration is in this direction. Okay, very good, Yash. So you are getting acceleration as a positive quantity. Now for E, remember, I'm still talking about the block E only. So the mass was how much? It was 10 kilograms. So I have mg sin theta minus tension is equal to ma. That is my first equation. And theta was 37 degrees. So this equation will become 100 newtons into sin 37. So that is 60 minus t is equal to 10e. This is the first equation. And this, both the things are known, a and t, so I cannot solve it alone. Whereas the second equation is just telling me normal reaction, so it's not really important for me. N minus mg cos theta is equal to 0. But it's not going to be of much use because it will just tell me that the normal reaction is 80 newtons. But that's not really important for me. Okay. Now let us come to B's free body diagram. Now B's free body diagram is very simple. B pe do hi forces act kar rahe hain. Let's say its mass is m prime and tension T, and it should have the same magnitude of acceleration but going up. Okay. And for B, the mass is given to us as, how much was the mass? It was 5 kg, right? So for B, the equation becomes T minus m prime g is equal to m prime into the same magnitude of acceleration. So this is our third equation in our system. So this equation is becoming T minus 50 is equal to 5a. So this equation. Okay, so hope this is clear, people. Yeah, I mean, you have to just check your connection also once, because alright, so now let us see what equations we have to solve. The second equation is of no use to us, but first equation and third equation, t is unknown and acceleration is unknown. So just look at the first equation, which is 60 minus t is equal to 10a, and look at the second equation, which is t minus 50 is equal to 5a. Now we can just add these two equations. So on adding these two equations, t cancels out. So we get this e. So our acceleration comes out to be 10 by 15 or 2 by 3. And luckily for us, it's positive. So that means our acceleration's direction is correct. So it is 0.67 or 2 by 3 meters per second squared. So since A is coming out to be positive, okay, so our assumption about direction was correct. Since A is positive on solving, so that implies that our assumption about direction is correct. Okay. Now I'll also show you that if I had taken the wrong assumption here, I would have got the same magnitude of acceleration, but I would have got with a minus sign. So the minus sign would have just told me that I need to reverse the direction, but rest of the things are fine. Okay. And about tension, now substitute E equal to 2 by 3 in, let's say, equation 3. So you will get T is equal to 50 plus 5A. So 50 plus 10 by 3. So that's becoming how much? 150 plus 10, 160 divided by 3. So the tension is 53.33 newtons. Okay. You can see the tension has to be larger than B's weight because B is going up. But at the same time, it has to be less than mg sin theta for A, because otherwise A would not be sliding down. So that's another thing you can analyze from the result over here, that tension is greater than m prime g, that is B's weight. So that assures us that B is moving up. And also T is less than mg sin theta. So mg sin theta dominates. Okay, is weights component, tangential component. Tangential means parallel to the inclined surface. So that is why it implies that A is sliding down the inclined plane. Okay, if we had got tension to be, you know, let's say more than 60, then it would have been a wrong result. Okay, because how can T be greater than 60 when mg sin theta for A was 60? Then it would not make sense that A is sliding down the inclined plane. Okay, so I'll just try to minimize this a little once more. So just make sure you are clear with all the steps, including the critical steps which are resolving the forces for the first free body diagram and then converting the free body diagram into equations. So always remember, along an inclined plane, if a body is moving along an inclined plane, you always take the direction of the inclined plane as your x-axis and the direction perpendicular to the inclined plane as your y-axis. And that is why when you resolve your forces with this x and y axis, the resolution of weight is always like this, that the component of mg, which will be here, this will be mg cos theta and this one will be mg sin theta. If the inclined plane is making theta with the horizontal, then when you resolve the weight, always remember that the normal component of mg becomes mg cos theta. Okay, this is a very important result. N number of problems we use this, and the tangential component is always mg sin theta, provided theta is the angle of the inclined plane with the horizontal. Should not be with the vertical, of course. Okay, people, so hope this is clear. Okay. Okay, let's pick up another question for practice. Okay. This time I want you people to solve it fully, that is. Okay, so in our next example, we have like a double incline like this. Okay, so this angle is 37 degrees again, and this angle is 90 degrees. Okay, this is what is given to us, and as usual, there is a pulley attached. Okay. A light thread going round the pulley. Okay, and both surfaces are smooth, so no friction involved anywhere. Friction, of course, will come for us at a later stage. So up till that point, in this chapter, all surfaces will be smooth. Okay, so the pulley is again smooth and massless. Okay, the string is also massless and inextensible. Now take g equal to 10 meters per second square. Okay. Now in part one of the question, if the mass of the block E is 20 kgs, okay, and mass of the block B is just a second. Yeah, mass of the block B is, suppose, 10 kgs. Okay, you have to find the accelerations. Okay, and in the second case, we will take mass of A to be 15 kg and mass of B to be again 10 kgs. No, this time we will take mass of B with 12 kgs. Okay. Again, find the accelerations. Okay, so work this out quickly. Take G as 10 meters per second square. Okay, anybody got the answer for the first part? Getting 2, is it? Okay, I'll work it out and tell you. I just need to find the acceleration. The rest you don't need to solve for anything else in this particular question. Okay, just so I think you should get the acceleration in the first part as 5 by 3 meters per second square, or that is approximately 1.67 meters per second square, with A coming down the incline and B going up the incline. This is the result you should be getting. I'll verify it, but okay. Now see, in this question, because there are two sets of values, no? I will first write the equations with just the parameters, that is in terms of masses MA and MB, and then I'll substitute, and automatically from the substitution I'll give both the set of answers for one as well as for two. So I'll take the same assumption for both the parts. Okay, now let me assume that because this side is steeper, so it kind of makes logical sense that if, unless the masses are very different, okay, for example, you know that if the masses had been same, then definitely B would be sliding down and A would be sliding up. So let me start with that assumption. My equations will tell me whether my assumption is correct or wrong for each of the parts. Okay, so I'm taking that as A, and I'm taking the tension in the string as T. Same tension everywhere. Okay, now instead of, you know, making a separate diagram and all, this time I will resolve the forces in the same diagram. So let me start with the resolution of the weights. So ye wala kitna ho jayega, this will be whatever mass of A is, the weight of A into sine 37. So I'm just writing this. This will be MAG sine 37, and this one will be MAG cos 37. Okay, and likewise, let me take this component and this component. Now see, the very important thing, this angle is 90, so this angle here is how much? It is 53 degrees, okay? So this one will be weight of this block into sine 53, and this one will be weight of this block into cos 53, okay? And then of course there will be two normal reaction forces on each of them. So those normal reactions I can just show with this here and this here. Okay, so this is the normal reaction on the block A. Okay, this is the normal reaction on the block B. And so instead of making separate FBDs, I've just marked the forces already resolved in the same diagram. Now let me write the equation. So for the block A, now this time I'm assuming the acceleration is upwards, so T minus weights sine component is equal to mass into acceleration. So without substituting the mass, I will just write this equation now as this, that T minus 3 by 5 times this weight is equal to this mass into acceleration. This is my equation 1. I'll make the generic equation so that I can substitute for each of the parts. Okay, and of course normal reaction equal to 0, but that equation is not so important for me. Now for B, because it's coming down the inclined plane, so this time the weight sine component minus the same tension is equal to B's mass into acceleration. So this will become 4 by 5 mass of B into G minus T is equal to mass of B into A. So this is the other important equation for me. Actually, it's just a matter of solving these two equations. The other two equations are not important for me, the normal reaction equations. So that's why I'm not labeling the equations. Okay, so now let me solve these. Okay, so with this assumption only that the accelerations are like this, solving equations 1 and 2. So for that you just add the equation 1 plus 2 kar do. So you can see that you will get 4 by 5 mbg minus 3 by 5 mag is equal to ma plus mb into e. So we can write this kind of generic equation for e. It is 4 times mass of e minus 3 times mass of e upon 5 into the sum of their masses, okay, whole thing into g. Aisa ek formula aa gaya. Now we can substitute for both the parts, okay, and depending on whether we are getting plus or minus, we can see that the direction. So for part 1, okay, just substitute mass of a as 20, mass of b as 10. So according to my assumption, I'll get a as a negative quantity. Let's see why. So a will come out to be 4 times, so that is 40 minus 60, yeah. So as expected, it will come out to be negative. Okay, divided by 5 into 20 plus 10 into 10. So see, I'm getting minus of 200 upon 5 into 30. So that's becoming how much now? Oh, so minus 4 by 3, correct. My bad, it was minus 4 by 3. So that means actually what is happening, that in this part, so this means that actually the motion is taking this way in this part. E will be sliding down the inclined plane instead of going up the inclined plane at an acceleration of 4 by 3, and B will be going up the incline at an acceleration of 4 by 3. Or okay, whereas for part B, just substitute the masses as given. For the second part, mass of A and mass of B, you substitute as 15 and 12, and this time I think you will get positive. So you don't need to write any new equations. It's the same thing. Just so that is the advantage of writing the equations parametrically here in terms of MA and MB instead of numerically. So we're getting how much? 60 minus 36. Oh, sorry. It's the other way around. 4 times MB. So that is 4 into 12. 48 minus 3 into 15. 45. Yeah, so I am getting positive value. So this will become 3 by 27 into 2, 9. So I'm getting acceleration as 2 by 9 meters per second square, or approximately 0.22 meters per second square. But now see, the sign is positive. So the sign is positive means that my assumption of acceleration was correct. So this time in the second part, the accelerations will be like this, that E will actually be sliding in this direction at 2 by 9 meters per second square. Just check the solution, whether it's 2 by 9 or 1 by 9. I'm getting 2 by 9 only. You can check my calculation once more, but I'm getting this. Just check the algebra once in case I made some mistake, but the equations are correct. this is what you should be getting. दीदी वी के नॉट डायरेक्टली मेक दैट अजम्पशन ना, बिकॉज यहाँ पे वेट वाली बात नहीं है, इट इज़ अबाउट द साइन कॉम्पोनेंट ऑफ वेट. सो इफ यू हैव टू मेक द करेक्ट अजम्पशन बाई एस्टिमेटिंग द मास. Have you understood? So it's not necessary that just because A's weight is more than B's, it will come down. It is basically A's sine component of weight has to be more than B's sine component of weight. Right na? Because what is pulling A down the inclined plane? It's not the weight, it's the sine component of weight. And that too which sine? Sine 37. Or B ko kya pull kar raha hai? It is B's weight's sine 53 component. So those are the two things actually. So that's why you know this value that we've got here na? That 4 by 5 MB minus 3 by 5 MA. ये कहाँ से आया? This is basically the sine component of B's weight minus the sine component of A's weight. You understood the point, beta? So if you have to directly compare, na, you have to compare the sine components of their weights, because that is the force which is pulling each one down the inclined plane. So which one dominates? You know whether B's sine component dominates or A's sine component dominates. That decides the direction of acceleration. Exactly. ठीक है. Okay, so this is clear to all of you, I hope. Okay. Now next we will discuss another type of problem. Now in this next problem, okay, I'll give you some time, finish it. Okay, now next type of example for us. Let us look at a problem where there is an equilibrium kind of situation. So there is this block of 10 kg mass. Okay. It's got two hooks on either side like this, and there are two separate threads. Connecting it like this to two walls. So there is a vertical wall here. A vertical wall here. So it is vertically suspended, it's not lying on any floor. It's vertically suspended, okay, like this, where what is happening is that the thread on the left, this angle is 45 degrees, whereas the thread on the right, this angle is 37 degrees. Okay, so you have to find the tension on each of the ropes. So if the tensions in the threads to the right side and left side are T1 and T2 respectively, find their magnitudes. Okay, so these are both light threads, this one and this one, they are both massless or light threads, which are also inextensible. So this is a comparatively simpler problem. All you have to do is make the free body diagram for the block. And solve for what is called equilibrium condition. So what is the equilibrium condition? It is the condition that net force should be zero. Yes, very good, Yash. The best way of solving this question would be using Lamy's theorem. But then when you use Lamy's theorem, you will also have to use the sin A plus B rule, because the angles, you know, will not be like the standard kind of angles. I mean, one of the angles, you know, it will be 45 plus 53. Or rather 45 plus 37. So these are our forces. Now also here, this angle is 37 degrees, whereas this angle is 45 degrees, okay. So that also means that this total angle is 143 degrees, this total angle is 135 degrees, and this angle is 82 degrees. So you can make use of Lami's theorem. Okay. So if you remember Lami's theorem, for the sum of three vectors to be zero, we had a conditional statement . So one is, you could make use of Lami's theorem here. So if you do that, then you'll get T1 upon sine 135 degrees is equal to T2 upon sine 143 degrees is equal to Mg upon sine 82 degrees, like this. Okay. Now for sine 82, you will have to manufacture some maths. So this will become T1 upon 1 by root 2, that will become T2 upon 3 by 5. Now that will become Mg, which is 100 newtons upon what? So for that, let's understand. Okay. So sine 82, which is basically sine 45 plus 37, can be written as sine 45 cos 37 plus cos 45 sine 37. So that can be written as, sorry, 1 by root 2 into 4 by 5 plus 1 by root 2 into 3 by 5. So we can write that as 7 upon 5 root 2. Okay, so this becomes 7 upon 5 root 2. So that way this equation becomes T1 into root 2 is equal to 5 by 3 T2 is equal to 5 root 2 by 7 into 100. So from this you can see that T1 is 500 by 7, or approximately 5 newtons, and T2 is equal to 60 newtons, something like this. Okay. So this is still a very convenient way of solving the problem, even though we have to actually use a trigonometric formula to come up with that 82 degree sine. It's still comparatively very convenient. Or we can also resolve. Okay. Alternately, we can use resolution into components also. Okay. So if we use resolution into components, this is what our forces are going to look like. example T2, you can see T2's vertical component will become T2 by root 2, and T2's horizontal component will also become T2 by root 2. Okay. And the other one, T1, its vertical component will become 4 by 5 T1 or T1 cos 37, and its horizontal component will become 3 by 5 T1 or T1 sin 37, because it was making an angle of 37 with the vertical. See, this T1 is making an angle 37 degrees here. So the one along that axis with whom it's making 37 degrees, that is T1 cos 37, and the other one is T1 sin 37. So that's how the resolution goes. And weight mg, which is 100 newtons. Okay. So after resolving the forces, we could have said that, okay, horizontally you have T2 by root 2 is equal to 3 by 5 T1, that is equation 1. And vertically you have T2 by root 2 plus 4 by 5 T1 is equal to mg. That's your second equation. So on solving these two, you see you will get these results. You will get these same results. Okay. But generally when we talk about what is called equilibrium of three forces, the vector sum of three forces being zero, or equilibrium of three forces, the first method that you should think about is the Lamy's theorem application.
Cookie, why did you dart here?
Okay, so people, hope this is clear. Yeah, finish writing this down, Tej. Yeah, see, it is always the angle opposite to, see, follow this diagram. This diagram of Lami's theorem. I'll show it again. So this one. This is the important one which has all the angles. A ke opposite jo angle hai, that is alpha. Okay, B ke opposite jo angle hai, that is beta. So this one. Okay. So see, the angle opposite to A, that is alpha. So I'll have A upon sine alpha. Okay. Then the angle opposite to B is beta. So that is B upon sine beta. And the angle opposite to C, that is gamma. So okay. So likewise, see, when I applied the Lami's theorem no, in this one here, T1 ke opposite mein kaun sa angle tha, this one, 135. You're following the point. Now, T1's opposite angle is this one, 135. So I have T1 upon sine 135. T2's opposite angle is 143. So like that. Because the statement of Lami's theorem is for 3, na? Vector sum of 3 is equal to 0. Statement of Lami's theorem mein 4th ya 5th force aa nahi sakta, na? See, you have to understand where Lami's theorem comes from. It comes from triangle. Okay, I will show you the proof of Lami's theorem. We have not done proof of Lami's theorem, na, in vectors. I think I told you I'll do it later, right? So we'll discuss it today. Yeah, I'll show you the proof of Lami's theorem. You'll understand that the theorem statement is applicable only for the sum of three vectors to be zero. Okay, so this proof, this Lami's theorem is very simple to prove. Okay, see, once again, if my three vectors are like this, and again, opposite to A, I have the angle alpha. Opposite to B, I have angle beta. And opposite to C, I have the angle gamma. So A plus B plus C is equal to 0. Also means that A, B, and C. So this implies this, that A, B, and C are adjacent sides of a closed triangle. When drawn head to tail, like we're doing the addition of displacements. If we draw the vectors instead of from a common origin, if we draw the vectors head to tail, then they should form a closed triangle, and only then the resultant will be zero. So now use these vectors, but in a diagram where we are drawing them head to tail. So A is my first vector like this. Okay. Then from A, I will draw the vector B. Okay. So B will, let's say, become like this. Sort of direction. Okay, so if this was A, this is B. You can see the angle between A and B, that is this angle, this one. So this angle here is gamma. Okay, then if the resultant is zero, then when I do A plus B plus C, that is, I place this third vector C over here, it should naturally fit over here. It should bring me back to the origin where I started from. That is the condition for the resultant to be zero. Okay. And in this, you can see that this angle, the angle between B's direction and C's direction, that is which angle? This one, no? So it's alpha. Okay. And finally, the angle between C's direction and A's direction, this one, that is between C and A, that is this one. So it's beta. Now in this triangle, it's very easy to show that this condition will be true. So for example, what you do is you drop a perpendicular from this vertex onto this side. You just drop this perpendicular. and let's say this perpendicular is some height h. So now you see on this triangle, okay, this side is b and this side is h. So h by b is perpendicular upon hypotenuse, and that should be sine of this angle. So sine of this angle is how much? Sine of 180 minus gamma. So I have h is equal to b sine gamma. That's equation one. And now look at this other triangle, this one. Okay, now for this, this side is c and this angle is how much? It is 180 minus beta. Okay, so perpendicular upon hypotenuse should be sine of that interior angle, which is 180 degrees minus beta. So what I'm getting from here, I'm getting h is equal to c sine gamma. Okay, now compare equations 1 and 2. So you'll get b sine gamma is equal to c sine, oh sorry, beta. This one will be, it's 180 minus beta, so here we have beta. Okay, this should be c sine beta. So that is giving us one of the three things, I mean two of the three statements, that b upon sine beta is equal to c upon sine gamma. Okay, now likewise we can drop another perpendicular in the same triangle. Okay, so in the same triangle, we can, this time instead of this one, we can drop another perpendicular. Okay, so let's say this time we drop the perpendicular from here like this. Okay, and we write this as P or whatever. So again you can see that you get two right angle triangles, this one and this one, and again from those two right angle triangles you can see that, okay, A by P is equal to sine beta. It will become 180 minus beta. And similarly on this side, B by P, sorry, P by B, perpendicular upon hypotenuse. So P by A, on the other side, P by B is equal to sine alpha. Sine 180 minus, so from this set, I'll get the other thing, that A upon sine alpha is equal to B upon sine beta. I'll get this. So now compare this and this together and you'll get the statement of Lamy's theorem, that the condition for the resultant of the three vectors to be zero is strictly that the ratio of A and sine alpha should be exactly equal to the ratio of A and of B and sine beta, and that should be exactly equal to the ratio of C and sine gamma. So you will be studying this in trigonometry also later, and in trigonometry this is called the sine rule for a triangle, and there's a relation between the sine of the angles in any triangle and the side lengths, and that is this only. Yeah, right, write it down, it's fine. Just understand the steps here, because I'll be sending you the notes anyway. Make sure all the steps are clear.
कम क्योंकि
राइट, सो होप दिस इज क्लियर नाउ। So this is a 30 degree incline and now this time we've got very interesting type of system. So what we have is there is one pulley over here which will be attached to this corner, okay, and then there will be one more pulley here. So we have this thread going around this pulley. And then we have another pulley in our system. So this one is attached here. And then the thread is going around the second pulley and down the incline over here, and it's attached to one block B over here, and it's attached to one block A over here. Okay, all the surfaces are frictionless, and both the pulleys are smooth and massless, and the thread used to join the blocks A and B, that is also massless and inextensible. So all surfaces are smooth. Okay, both pulleys are smooth and massless. Okay, the thread is massless and inextensible. Okay, so if A and B have the same mass, let's say 20 kilograms, and g is equal to 10 meters per second square, find their accelerations and the tension in the thread. Yes, hope the concept is clear here. Okay, so anybody got the answer? What about the acceleration? Yes, is correct. G by 4 should be the answer. Good, you should be getting the acceleration as G by 4 and therefore the tension equal to mg by 4. So what is mg? 20, 200, so 200, yeah, 50 newtons, correct. So you should be getting the acceleration as 2.5 meters per second square or G by 4. And you should be getting the tension as 1/4 the weight or 50 newtons. Okay. So I'll just quickly make the free body diagrams for you, those who haven't got it yet. Okay. Then we'll discuss the second part also of this question. So we can directly analyze the forces here itself. We don't need to make a separate FBD. So first of all, whatever tension is created because of the mg sine theta of this one, that tension is same throughout because both the pulleys are smooth and the thread is massless, no? So uniform magnitude of tension throughout. So that's the first thing, okay? And then the other forces are very simple. On A, for example, there is weight acting downwards, which does not disturb anything at all because normal reaction balances it. So iska acceleration agar aisa hai, is the same as this one's acceleration down the inclined plane. Now this one's weight we will break into components. So this is mg sine 30 and this component is mg cos 30. Okay, and the normal reaction acting on this is n. Okay, so for A we have the equation P is equal to ma, very simple equation. And for B we have the equation mg sine 30 minus t is equal to ma. Both have the same mass. So from this you can see that you will get mg by 2 on adding the two equations is equal to 2 ma. So you get acceleration is equal to g by 4. And substitute this in equation 1. So you'll get tension is equal to mg by 4. And that's it. That's how it gets. So that's this part. Now we'll do a second part of the question where what we are now doing is that ओके वेरी गुड, ठीक है। सो इन द सेकेंड पार्ट ऑफ द क्वेश्चन, नाउ देर इज सम एक्सटर्नल एजेंट हियर हु इज पुलिंग द ब्लॉक ए विद अ हॉरिजॉन्टल फोर्स एफ। ओके सो मैन पुल्स ब्लॉक ए विद हॉरिजॉन्टल फोर्स F as shown, so that the system will be in equilibrium. Okay, so you want to now find the force he is applying and the tension in the thread. Okay, so anybody got it? Yeah, tension will have to be 50 newton, that's correct. And therefore, what about the force? That will also be equal to 50 newtons. Because see, what is happening here is, when you look at this block, you can understand, mg sine theta has to be blocked by, because now its acceleration is zero, no? So from this, you can understand that tension has to be equal to mg sine theta. So that is 50 newtons. Okay. So there's no other way out. You know, you don't want the block B to move. So the string's tension has to be that much. Then you look at A's free body diagram and you can understand A's acceleration is also zero. So this is telling you the amount of force you're applying is equal to the amount of tension. So F is equal to T equal to mg sine theta. So that is telling you that F's magnitude is equal to T's magnitude, which will be 50 newtons, because I think we've taken the mass as 10 kg. No, Tej, obviously we apply force zero, then this block will slide, na? अगर इस पे कुछ फोर्स नहीं लग रहा है क्यों उसका मास 20 था कि 10 था व्हाट वी हैव टेकन द मास ऑफ द ब्लॉक एज अच्छा 20 के जी आया करेक्ट देन इट विल बी करेक्ट माय मिस्टेक सो दिस विल बी 100 नॉट 50 एम जी साइन थीटा विल बी 20 इंटू 10 इंटू साइन 30 सो दैट विल बी 100 न्यूटन्स ओके Okay, so it has to be 100 newtons. Okay, now I want to turn to a bit of discussion of some of the questions from the assignment. Okay, I'll just give you some guidelines because I want you to spend some more time on doing the assignments based on what we've learned today also. Okay, and also you can start doing questions from H.C. Verma. Okay, from the next lecture onwards, we'll be discussing H.C. Verma questions also, a few of them in the class. So hope this question is fully clear to all of you. Okay. So now I will send you a list. Okay. But to begin with, just a second. I want to discuss some questions from the first workbook. Rather from the first assignment, okay. Yeah. Okay, so for example, in these two questions, okay. In this question and this question, you have to basically understand that net force is equal to mass into acceleration. So you have to calculate the net force by vector sum, by vector addition. Okay, so you can use triangle law. Or component method. For that, okay, so you can see here. In the first case, in the case A, when you look at the diagram from top, now the two forces are acting perpendicular to each other and they are of same magnitude. So their vector sum, the resultant of the two will become like this. This will be the net force. Okay. Now in the second part, the same thing, the forces that are acting, one of them is 2F0 like this and the other one so is F naught in magnitude and the angle is 45 degrees. Okay. So your net force will become like this. So this net force you'll need to calculate and then use net force is equal to mass into acceleration. So this is the way of doing this second question. Okay. First question is direct statement of Newton's first law. Okay. First some C part. Okay. I'll tell you. So if the two objects are tied together, what is the acceleration? Okay. So see what is happening is now from this data, from the data of this part, okay, and this part, okay. Second object, 8 when the same force is. So you know the ratio of masses. If you know that, suppose first mass is m, then you know that second mass is how much. So now when you tie both the masses together, you know the total mass, no? So you know that same amount of force will produce how much acceleration. Okay, understood, Yash. Sorry, Tej. You understood C part how to do it? Assume कर लो कि first वाला mass m है, so second mass you can find out how much it is in terms of m. Okay, use the second statement given. Okay, see what is happening. The first mass is m suppose, so f naught by m is how much? 4. Whereas f naught by m2 is how much? 8. So obviously the mass is half, no? So this is telling you that this mass m2 is m by 2. So now use that in this system. You're tying the two masses together with a thread and you're applying the same force. So just use the free body diagram method now. Or it becomes a combined object of m1 plus m2. So use that concept. Okay, so try it out by this method. Yes, okay. Rather, Tejas, try it out by this method. Okay. Then let's see what else we can discuss here. So I think these questions are all pretty standard. Should be able to do them. Third, see here, many of the questions you have to use kinematics. See, it's telling you that the speed is increasing 10 meters per second every 2 seconds. So you have to use kinematics, that acceleration kya hai, rate of change of velocity. So change in velocity is 10 in a time interval of t. So the acceleration is how much? Delta v by delta t. That kind of concept you have to use. Okay. Then same thing over here. Displacement and versus time is given. So how you will find acceleration? S is equal to half a t square. So from that you know the acceleration, then use F is equal to ma. So some of the questions are very basic things like this. Okay. Okay, now this is a bit of a complicated question. Okay. The seventh one. So let me explain part of the seventh question. So in seventh question, what is happening? The acceleration due to gravity, now this is given by this kind of formula that at a certain height, it is equal to acceleration due to gravity on the surface upon radius of Earth plus the height square. I mean radius of Earth square plus the height square, now into radius of Earth square, like this. Okay, and the radius of the Earth is given to you. Okay, so वेट ऑफ अ पर्सन क्या होता है? वेट ऑफ अ पर्सन इज एम जी. सो वेट ऑफ द पर्सन ऑन द अर्थ सर्फेस इज एम जी नॉट. सो वेट ऑफ द पर्सन एट अ हाइट ऑफ एच विल बिकम एम इन टू जी एट एच. सो यू यूज दिस फॉर्मूला टू सब्स्टिट्यूट. सो इट बिकम्स एम जी नॉट इन टू दिस फैक्टर, रेडियस ऑफ अर्थ स्क्वायर अपॉन रेडियस ऑफ अर्थ स्क्वायर प्लस हाइट स्क्वायर. So for example, when the height is 300 kilometers, you substitute h as 300 kilometers here. It's a bit of a big calculation, but you know, now in this you can substitute mg naught as basically what, 80 multiplied by 9.8, because the mass is 80 kg. Okay, and the acceleration due to gravity on the surface of the earth is 9.8, but then you are multiplying with this factor, which is this thing, 6370 square upon 6370 square plus 300 square. Okay, whereas what about the mass of the person? Okay, the mass of the person is independent of altitude. Mass does not change with altitude. Mass or inertia is independent of gravity. It is weight which changes with gravity, because weight is the gravitational force. Okay, so you have to just use the formula given and substitute to find the new value of small g at this height, and the weight at that height will become the original mass only multiplied by g. Okay, yeah, let's look at fifth sum also then. So fifth sum, okay, in order to drag a 100 kg log along the ground at constant velocity, you have to pull it with a force of 300 newtons. Okay, so what is the resistive force applied by the ground? So imagine this is the log of wood and you're pulling it on the rough ground, but to move it at constant velocity, that means acceleration is zero, you are having to apply some kind of a force. Okay, so what is happening to this force? Why it's not producing acceleration? Because there is some kind of drag force, or what we call friction. There's some kind of drag force that the earth is applying on it. So F is just getting balanced by that drag force. Acceleration is zero means that what is happening? The net force on the body is zero. So whatever force you are applying, it is just balancing the drag force. Now you have the information that the force you are applying is how much? It is 300 newtons. So the drag force is how much? It's exactly equal to 300 newtons. Okay. Now the same thing, if you want the block to move at a certain acceleration, then you have to increase the amount of force you are applying. Nah? So what will happen is now you have to increase the force to some F prime, but the drag force will remain the same. So the drag force is still 300 newtons, but you have increased the force to some value so that now you're getting some acceleration. So this new value of force minus the drag force, which is 300 newtons, is the mass into acceleration. Now mass is given to you. So you substitute everything and find out F prime from this. Okay. All right. Let's move on to the next page. Okay, so I think now 8th and 9th are kind of questions that you should be able to solve. Okay. Again, they are about free body diagram. Just a minute. Try and get this under control. So 8th and 9th are again free body diagram problems. Okay, so you'll understand that like we had solved a question based on this kind of thing before. So between these blocks, there will be some kind of contact force. This will be applying a contact force N on this. This will apply an equal and opposite contact force on this. So when you take the 2 kg blocks, this thing, free body diagram, there is force F from this side and there is this normal force from this side and it has an acceleration A. Whereas when you take the 1 kg block, it has a normal force from this side and the acceleration is E. So these two FBDs will help you solve. Similarly, this is just vector sum of F1 plus F2 should be equal to mass into acceleration. So you can solve the vector sum by using triangle law or by component method or whatever you like. Okay. Okay, let's come to the next page. I think once again, 10th question is also very simple. You have to just do the vector sum in component algebra. Then that net force is mass into acceleration. So you'll get the acceleration vector by dividing by the mass, which is 4 kg. And then just calculate the magnitude of that vector and velocity at time t, kinematics. You know? And where is the object? That means you have to calculate displacement. Okay. Now let's come to 11th question. Some of you have asked for 11th and 12th question. These are actually calculus based problems. Okay, so I'll explain. So in 11th and 12th question, in 11th, for example, you are given that velocity is some constant into t into 12 minus t square like this in meters per second. So just open this bracket. So it is this 12 v naught t minus v naught t cube. This is v. Okay, so this is it. So what will be the momentum of the body at the instant when the net force is zero? So from this we can see, you can find the acceleration as dv by dt. So just differentiate this term. Okay, so differentiation of this term is pretty easy to do. 12 v naught minus 3 v naught into t square. Now this is the acceleration. Now the force therefore is mass into acceleration. So the force is zero at the instant when acceleration is zero. So put this acceleration equal to zero, you'll get the time. And now put the time back in the velocity. So you'll get the momentum as mass into velocity. Okay. So find the time at which acceleration is zero, find the time in seconds and substitute that time in seconds in this equation to get the velocity at that instant. So momentum is mass into velocity. Okay, Krish, you understood the 11th one, Shweta and Krish. So by differentiating velocity, you're getting acceleration. So you want to find out at what time the force is zero. That means at that time, the acceleration should be zero. So whatever acceleration you've got as a function of time, na, usko zero put kar do. So when you put this as zero, you'll see you'll get the time here as what? You'll get it as square root of 4. Na? So you'll get it as 2 seconds. Now substitute this time of 2 seconds back in velocity. So you'll know the velocity at that instant, and momentum is nothing but mass into velocity, and mass of the body is m. So, okay. Now the same principle of rate of change kind of concept you have to use for the 12th question also. So in 12th, what is happening? It moves along the x-axis such that the position is given by this relation, where alpha and beta are constants. Okay, so we have to find the force acting on it when the velocity becomes zero. So velocity is first derivative dx by dt. So that is 4 alpha t cube minus 3 beta t square. Okay, and acceleration is the rate of change of velocity. So differentiate this one more time. So this becomes 12 alpha t square minus 6 beta t. Okay, so I've got velocity as a function of time, I've got acceleration as a function of time. Now see what the question is asking. The question is asking me to find out the velocity when the force is zero. Okay, so f is zero when acceleration is zero. So from this you can see that is 12 alpha t square minus 6 beta t is zero. So this will give you two roots, either t is zero or t is equal to 2 times alpha by beta, sorry, 1 by the beta by 2 alpha. Yeah, so velocity when force is 0, so force is 0 when acceleration is 0, so that is either 0 seconds or beta by 2 alpha. So substitute this in this equation, so you get the velocity. Okay, or vice versa for the first part. Okay, that what is the force acting when the velocity is 0, put velocity equal to 0, get the time substituted in acceleration, so you get the force. Okay, so this should also be pretty straightforward. Okay, just a moment. Yeah, I'll explain the 13th sum. So kya ho raha hai in this question? In the 13th sum, inside the gun, inside the muzzle of the gun, that is like the barrel of the gun, whatever is happening. So let's say a bullet starts from this point at initial velocity 0, and by the time it comes out, it has got a velocity v, and that V is given to us as 500 meters per second. Okay, and the length of the barrel L is given to us as 0.5 meters. So inside we can find out the average acceleration. Okay, so if average acceleration is A, then half, or this we can use this equation V square by 2A, that one. Just a second. So we can use the relation that because initial velocity was 0, okay, so this v square is equal to 2al over here. So from this we can find out A, because v is known to us. Okay, so the average force will be equal to mass into average acceleration. That average acceleration is this. Okay, so Tej, hope the 13th question is clear to all of you. Okay. Then 14th is pretty simple. Again, vector sum of forces you have to do. 15th is also simple. Okay. The two forces in the horizontal plane are given and all that. Okay. So that is this assignment. Now about the workbook. Okay, I want to tell you what you have to do in the workbook actually. So in this workbook, now you have to only make the free body diagrams. You don't have to do any calculation in this. This workbook is very specific. It is not an exercise actually. It is just a sort of practice workbook for you to learn to make free body diagrams. So you have to only make free body diagrams for each block or body, okay, in each of these. So for example, when it comes to this question, you just understand that on small m, what are the forces which are acting? There will be external force, some kind of normal reaction, some kind of normal reaction from the ground, and weight. Whereas on capital M, there'll be normal reaction from this side, there'll be only three forces and normal reaction from the ground. Okay, now these ones are very important. In these ones, now you have to understand how the contact forces act. So in this, think carefully about the normal contact force from the wall. What is the direction in which each one acts? Okay, so I will be discussing some of the free body diagrams, the difficult ones, in class next time. So just make sure that you make the free body diagram and keep it ready for reference with you. Okay, so that when I'm discussing them, it is clear to you. Okay, and in this one, the diagram is slightly, let me correct the diagram. Its alignment is gone. So this last one, the diagram is something like this. For this one, it is on an inclined plane of theta. You have two blocks like this. Okay, capital M and small m, which are in contact with each other like this. Okay, and all surfaces are smooth. In all these, all surfaces are frictionless or smooth everywhere. In all the problems. Okay, so this is just for you to practice the free body diagram concept. Okay, now for this week's assignment, I will be sending you again a combination of two things, a workbook as well as an assignment. Okay, now the assignment will start having systems with pulleys and, you know, inclined plane problems and things like that, whereas the workbook will again be about more the basics. Okay, yeah, I will be discussing the free body diagrams with you. See, because here this is not a numerical answer, no? So there's no answer key as such. No, it is just about making the free body diagrams carefully. Okay, so we'll be discussing, don't worry. Okay, so anyway, that's it for today's session, people. Okay, I'll send you the recording and the notes, and now also I will send you a list of questions from H.C. Verma's Newton's laws chapter, not the forces chapter, but the Newton's laws chapter, the direct one. Okay, so you can start attempting those questions, and you can also go through the solved examples from the Newton's laws chapter in H.C. Verma. Okay, so that's it. Wishing you all the best, people.